So we come to the more exhortational part of these messages from the Epistle to the Hebrews, and in particular chapter 10. First of all, let's just trace through that theme that runs through the whole of the Epistle. Let us therefore. If we go first of all back to chapter 4 of the Epistle, chapter 4 and verse 1. Paul says here, let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. Let us therefore fear. We know, don't we, that as the Proverbs tell us, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So here is the beginning of our theme as well, that of fear. It's the Greek word phobos, from which we get our word phobia. Some have said it just means a respect. It does mean that, but it means more than that. Because, just to think about this for a moment, I could have respect to what you say, but I don't necessarily agree with it. That is no use when it comes to the Almighty. He is right in all things, and there is no way we can question anything that he says. So maybe, as we see on the screen here, a better definition of that word will be an awesome respect, knowing that God is in heaven, he is in control of all things, and he is always right. So that's the beginning of our theme, let us fear. In the same chapter, at verse 11, we read there, let us labour therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief, that unbelief that was displayed by many in the nation of Israel. So we need to labour, the works of faith, we labour to enter into the kingdom, into that rest, when we can rest from the labours that we labour just now. Still in chapter 4 and at verse 14, we read, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. And this we look at in more detail in chapter 10, when the apostle speaks about those who made a good start, as it were, but they didn't hold fast to that which they believed. It's translated lay hold in chapter 6 and verse 18. Let us therefore come boldly. If we just look in chapter 10 now, as we say here, it's the same word that we see in verse 1 of that chapter, where it's translated in the same way really. Let us therefore come boldly. Verse 1 of the chapter. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of those things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers, and that's the same word there, unto perfect. But we can be made perfect pertaining to the conscience through the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore we come boldly to the throne of grace. Let us therefore go on, once again, same idea, let us go on to moral and spiritual perfection. Not that we can be perfect in ourselves, but through the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us draw near, and here we've got the theme of chapter 10. Let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith. Let us hold fast again, here in chapter 10. Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, we read in chapter 12 and at verse 1. Also in chapter 12, wherefore, let us have grace by serving acceptably And we'll look at that verse in a little bit of detail in a moment. Let us go forth therefore unto him without the camp. What do we read in Revelation? These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. And then finally in chapter 13, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. So here we see this theme does actually run right through the whole of the epistle. And we say here, do we need to do anything? And it's rather a foolish question, really, isn't it? Bearing in mind what we have on the screen before us, let us fear, let us labour, let us hold fast, etc. Because there are those who say there is nothing that we can do to earn eternal life. And it's one of those statements which is a mixture of truth and error, because no one is saying, as far as I'm aware, that we can earn eternal life. But at the same time, we need to work so that we might enter into that rest. So just going back to this verse 28 of chapter 12, that's the verse there. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace. How do we have grace? By serving God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. That word whereby denotes the channel of an act. That's how we have grace, by serving God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Because it is possible to read that verse and get the impression that, well, the grace comes first, and because of that we serve God acceptably. So thinking of scripture as a whole, we say, which comes first, the grace or the acceptable service? And scripture is full of examples. Let's just look at one, that of Abraham. By myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing. It's because Abram did that thing. That's why he received the promises. And Paul tells us, doesn't he, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that which he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Not that we are earning anything by doing these things, but these are the works of faith, are they not? So, just going back to the law that we considered in our first session, we say here, is the law through Moses necessary? We say it was necessary, and it is necessary. It taught Israel, in very graphic terms, that sin alienates from God. And it taught them in graphic terms also that we are alienated from God through sin, but it leads to death. And it's only through the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ, not these animal sacrifices, that these sins can be completely atoned for. It shows the wonder of the work of the Lord Jesus Christ in reconciling those who have come to God through him. It's an amazing concept, and a humbling concept, is it not? How that the whole work of the Lord Jesus Christ was to reconcile us to God. As Paul puts it elsewhere, it was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. But that had its limitations, as we saw in the first session. First of all, these animal sacrifices only gave a temporary covering for sin, and sin was always on the conscience. And furthermore, they gave no pleasure to God. The sacrifice of Christ was pleasing to his Father because it brought many sons to glory, and by doing his Father's will, Jesus has sanctified all who come to God through him. And that, I suppose, summarises the first part of chapter 10. We're moving into the second part now. So in this section, we have a number of things that Paul deals with. First of all, he reminds us of our exalted position in Christ in verses 19 to 21. He then speaks about what our response should be, and furthermore, what are our responsibilities in Christ. And he finishes this section by asking the question, do we draw near or do we draw back from the Almighty? And that really returns to the theme of the earlier verses in the chapter. Obviously, we need to draw near in full assurance of faith. We're not amongst those who draw back. So, thinking of our exalted position in Christ, verse 19, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Remember, they could not do that under the law. And we show here that that word, and how it's used elsewhere in the epistle, it's translated confidence, boldly, and confidence again there in chapter 10 of the epistle. But we do it with due reverence. Remember, we started the theme by thinking about the fear of God. A casual approach is not acceptable, and we learnt that from the way in which the high priest had to approach to God, not in the way that he thought, but in the acceptable way as Lord laid down in the law. And we too must do it in the way that God decides and not the way that we do. Verse 20 we read, it's by a new and living way which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. He has gone through the veil, through the offering of his body. He has consecrated us through the veil. We read in chapter 6 and verse 19 of the epistle. Verse 21, we have an high priest over the house of God. It's not a high priest as it was in the days of Israel, in the wilderness, or when they entered the land for that matter, but the high priest that we have is of course none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. If we just go back to chapter 2 of the epistle and verse 17, wherefore in all things it behoved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succour them that are tempted. Or again at chapter 4 and verse 14, where we read, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. We have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And that verse reminds us, we find mercy and grace in time of need. Our walk should be to please our Heavenly Father, but when we fail, that is the time of need, and that's when the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ is so important for our forgiveness. So what should be our response in Christ? The Apostle tells us back in chapter 10 and at verse 22, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. We've got a number of things to consider there. We draw near. Remember, Israel could not do that. If we go back to chapter 7 and at verse 25, wherefore he is able to save them to the utmost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. We draw near with a true or a sincere heart, no hypocrisy, and a true heart is necessary if we are to draw near to God. We can do it in the most certain confidence, so we don't do it timidly and shyly, just hoping somehow God will be merciful to us through the sacrifice of Christ and our faith and our works of faith. We can do it in the most certain confidence. We do it having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience. Remember, that's what the children of Israel had on their minds all the time. They had this conscience of sin, and we can be relieved of that through the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. We do it having our bodies washed with pure water. And to expand on that a little bit, let's go outside the epistle to the Hebrews. Go to Ephesians chapter 5 and at verse 26. Well, just go back to verse 25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church, that he gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. And so that's how our bodies are washed, with pure water. And if we read the word daily, we will be cleansed from the filthiness of the world, as it were. And that's why it's so important to read the word every day, so that we might be constantly reminded of those things which are pure, and our bodies might be washed in that way. We need to hold fast the profession of our hope firm to the end. If we just come back to Hebrews 10, and Paul expands on that from verse 32 onwards. He says, call to remembrance the former days in which, after ye were illuminated, ye endured a great fight of afflictions. So once they learned the truth, they were illuminated, they endured a great fight of afflictions. Partly, he says, whilst ye were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly while ye became companions of them that were so used. For ye had compassion of me in my bonds, and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and an enduring substance. That's the way they behaved to begin with, Paul says. And this is at verse 35. Cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. Ye have need of patience and endurance. And the hint here is that they had made a good start, but they were falling away in various ways. And the exhortation is there for us, isn't it, that we need to hold fast, we need to endure to the end, that we might be saved. So we come to our responsibility in Christ. Verse 24. Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. So this is our responsibility, one to another, to provoke one another to love and to good works, or to stimulate one another to love and to good works. Because that's the way that God is. He shows his love to thousands of them that keep his commandments. If you love me, says Jesus, keep my commandments. Or later on in John's Gospel, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Or the Epistle of John here, 1 John chapter 5. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. But as we know, we can't keep his commandments to perfection, and that's why the sacrifice of the Lord is so important. So we have to love one another. Let's consider this for a moment and make the comparison between the very best form of human love and this godly love, or agape, as we sometimes refer it. You see, human love is always focused on this life, those things which are temporal, how to please one another in this life. Whereas godly love is focused on eternal things, because God himself, he is eternal. In other words, it's focused on the kingdom. The very best form of human love puts others first and self last, which is a good ideal, but there's something missing, isn't there? You see, godly love places God first, his word first, his ways, and then others, and finally self last. So human love seeks the temporal welfare of others, how they can be cared for in this life only, whereas godly love seeks the eternal welfare of others, in other words, how they might attain to the kingdom. Human love doesn't understand godly love, because it's on an entirely different level, whereas godly love understands that the cross has to come before the crown, as it did with the Lord Jesus Christ, and so it is with us, that our characters may be moulded to make us fit for that kingdom age. And most important, human love will always fail, because it concentrates on this life, which is temporal. Whereas, as Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 13, godly love will never fail, because it's concerned with eternal things. So our responsibility in Christ is to provoke one another to love and to good works, and also not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. And we've given the Greek word there, and we say, what, to whom is the apostle speaking? Initially, it was, of course, an appeal to those who were trying to return to the synagogue, and the apostle is speaking to them, but he's speaking to us as well, is he not? Because if we want to take the blessings, we can't ignore the responsibilities. We say, to whom does verses 19 to 21 refer? Speaking about boldness to enter into the holiest, and all the other things that we consider the blessings, we have to accept the responsibilities as well. He says, if we sin willfully, or the original really means, if we continue to sin willfully, there remaineth no more sacrifice. Or in other words, the sacrifice of the Lord does not cover those who continue to sin willfully. And we say, what is willful sin? It's sin committed knowing that it's wrong, because there's a difference between sins of ignorance and willful sin. It comes out in the Old Testament. He shall have one law for him that sinneth through ignorance, both for him that is born among the children of Israel, and for the stranger that sojourneth among them. But the soul that doth aught presumptuously, this is willful sin, whether he be born in the land or a stranger, the same reproacheth or blasphemes the Lord, and that soul shall be cut off from among his people. And the principle is the same when we come into the New Testament. So, what, first of all, does it not refer to? This phrase is not speaking about any sin, whether it's willful or not, which is acknowledged and repentance follows. We think of that great sin of David when he committed adultery with Bathsheba and then compounded it by murdering Uriah. He says, I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and clear when thou judgest. He's acknowledging that God is right and that he is wrong. And he says, behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. So not just a casual acknowledging of the fact that God is true, but truth in the inward parts, and there's true repentance. We read this in John, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, this is continuing to commit sin, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin. So if we walk in the light, if our way of life is to walk that straight and narrow path to the kingdom, when we stray from it, yes, we sin. But that's when the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk, even as he walked. He, the Lord, walked it to perfection. We walk it to the best of our ability. And so we look at verse 26 of Hebrews chapter 10, where we read, well, we've read it already, haven't we? If we sin willfully, if we continue to sin willfully, I suppose really in the context, if we walk away from the truth, but the principle is the same, if we continue in sin without acknowledging that it's wrong, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin. But as Paul says in verse 27, a certain fearful looking for a judgment and fiery indignation which shall devour the adversaries. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much sorer punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy, who hath trodden under foot the Son of God, account of the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified, an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. And this is what we do if we continue to walk in sin or walk away from the truth. And so we come to the final section where Paul asks this question, do we draw near or do we draw back? Verse 35, cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward, for ye have need of patience or endurance, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For it is a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. If any man draw back, draw away from God, my soul shall have pleasure no pleasure in him. But we are not of them that draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. And so Paul exhorts us, let us draw near with a true heart, a heart loving truth, in full assurance, most certain confidence of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. And just finally, let's remind ourselves of the need to draw near to the Father through the Son. We know, don't we, that with the Father it is everlasting life. Going back to Psalm 51, David says there, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence." David realized that through his sin and persisting in not acknowledging his sin, he was, if we can put it this way, out of fellowship with his God. And he says, "Cast me not away from thy presence. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation," because with God there is, of course, salvation. "For with thee is the fountain of life, and with thee in thy light we shall see light. With thee there is forgiveness, that thou mayest be feared." And there in Psalm 139, the psalmist says, "How precious also are thy thoughts." The word means aims and purpose, because God's purpose with us is to do us good at our latter end. And if there are trials along the way, so be it. The Father has deemed that necessary, but his will is to do us good at our latter end, so that we might inherit the kingdom. And the psalmist says there, "How great is the sum of those purposes that God has with us. If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand." Then he says, "When I awake, I am still with thee." So God doesn't change. He is faithful. He will remain this way. It's not a case of one day is faithful and we wake up the next morning and it's different. God is faithful, and he will remain faithful if we can remain faithful to him, to obey his will to the best of our ability, so that the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ might be efficacious to us when we fall from that straight and narrow path.